I actually believe that if you don't have a certain amount of money or certain things going on for yourself, then maybe you shouldn't even be looking for relationships and women.
So you don't deserve joy if you're poor? You don't deserve love and joy if you're poor? What?
No, but it's like, if you ain't got no money, what are you doing swanning around in bars with women and stuff?
Oh, you don't have to go to a bar to find love. I love that you think love is only available in the bar.
I'm Julie Adenuga and this is Off The Table, where we supercharge the debate about the issues defining our lives that matter to everyone but seem to be dividing us like never before. So we have brought together a group of smart, passionate individuals from a range of backgrounds to have no-nonsense discussions, and today it's all about M-O-N-E-Y, aka the stuff that apparently makes the world go round. Stay tuned as we take money off the table. Okay, guys, so we are here to talk about money in the context of relationships. I can already see your minds turning. I feel like there's going to be a lot to say today. But let me introduce you first. We have the lovely Gina Martin.
Hello.
Activist and author. We have Margs, who has said himself is the number one podcaster in the world, country, what are you saying?
The world.
The world. Yeah. And content creator. Wow. And we also have Grace Blakeley, who's a political commentator. Let's start with a very fun question that everybody's going to have a great answer to. I'm going to start with you, Marks.
Right then.
Can money buy you love?
Yes. No, it can. And at the very least, it's going to give you more opportunities to find love. Do you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Because you're going to do better out there in the world in the dating pool if you can present yourself better. If you look nice, you're going to attract more females. And then that's when you wade through.
Females? Women?
Oh, is it not females? Sorry, women.
Is it not men?
I don't know. Gonna find more women and wade your way through the nonsense.
I enjoy you using the word wade. Keep going.
Yeah, you're gonna wade your way through the nonsense and then you're gonna find
the nonsense
serious,
females.
The nonsense ones.
As in the females that are not beaut.
No, the ones that are just there for the money.
Oh, okay.
Right. Does that undermine your original argument though?
Because
the money, you're more likely to attract that nonsense.
No, but
we are finished, everybody. Thank you for coming.
The money helps. If there's...
So we want women to be like, we don't like the girls that attract this money, but we want to have money to attract the women.
Well, what are you attracted to in a man?
Personality.
What about the way he presents himself? Because how do you know someone's
presenting
themselves when you
see them? Well, my partner, I met him in Budapest in a hostel and he was naked playing drums.
Wow.
So I wasn't really attracted to the money in that instance.
Your voice. What do you like?
Wait, yeah. Sorry.
The energy. Sorry, the energy.
What we're not going to do is skip over that. He was naked playing drums.
Not the first moment I saw him, but that was like the defining story because we were in a hostel and he'd done too many egg bombs. But we should move on to someone else now, actually.
Nah, I don't want him. So what kind of drums was he playing?
I don't remember.
Did
just
he have
like a rubbish.
Sticks or was it hands?
No, sticks. It was like an open mic night and he'd done like way too many Jager bombs. Don't drink. Drink responsibly.
Right.
And he was playing drums naked and I just thought, what a vibe. What a fun guy.
Didn't care how much money he had in his non-existent pockets.
We were in a hostel, so none of us had money.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you were like, this is the guy.
He's fun. Yeah, I like him. Let's chat.
So then do you think that money can buy you love?
No.
Okay.
No. Definitely come from a working class background, family, no money, but loads of love.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Grace? So apart from in your instance when it was a naked man, when you're
Geordie man in Budapest,
yeah.
when you're a physical attraction or physical appearance or whatever, mm-hmm. Don't you like a guy that's well presented or something? Ain't that going to be more attractive than someone that's random?
Yeah, but I don't. That's not defining for me.
I've dated a lot of very well presented guys, and as soon as they open their mouths, they are like boring or don't have anything to say for themselves.
They just
instantly
talk about money.
Several points knocked off.
Same.
Or they just talk about money. Yeah,
same.
It's not just about the way that you look.
But definitely the initial attraction is what got you there in the first place to have
the
conversation.
Yeah, but you're looking at someone's
face. I think, again, like initial attraction, this is why, like, so I don't know how you guys find like the dating apps, right? But I think like so many of the people that I've dated in the past, if I saw them on a dating app, I wouldn't swipe right. But then when you meet them, it's all about like the energy that there is between the two of you. So it's not actually just about appearance. It's about like.
And also, even
connection.
If it is that love or is that just like wanting to like, you know, someone? It's not love, is it?
Wanting to.
That's a very good question. So I'm not going to disagree with your point, Margs.
Go on.
I think what you said makes sense logically. If you have more money, you can do more things, you can be in more places, you can see more people, you have more chance of meeting someone that you're going to be interested in. But specifically, what you said, Gina, can it buy you love was the question. Not can it put you in a position where you can meet loads of people. Do you think money can buy you love?
No.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, go on. Tell us
why. I'm just sorry. So sometimes you could be attracted to someone for like their talents and that. Someone could do something and make it endearing to them. Like, I don't know, if you like music and you see a good singer and you see them singing and you think their voice is wonderful.
Right.
And then you're like, oh, I'm kind of attracted to them now.
Right.
You know what I'm trying to say? Making money is a talent. And some people, it is a talent.
Yo, you going from singing to making money, both of your talents is
making money
fantastic.
Is a talent, yeah. Right. And some people can like that and respect that, and it can be endearing. So when you see someone that's an entrepreneur and they're a goal getter and they've made something for themselves, maybe they come from nothing and now they're doing very well. That's
what if they
have
their money?
Right now,
yeah,
right now you're adding on. Because entrepreneurial is that is a whole next level of talent skills outside of money. But I'm saying if you had £1 million. Yeah. Right? Does that put you in a better position to fall in love than if you had zero?
Put you in a better position. Yes.
Yeah, but that's not love. That's a position you're in that could then lead
obviously,
to something.
Exactly. That's why it's just giving you the opportunity, but it's the root to all the evil.
Can I just add that I'm not going to give names, actually, that's a bad idea, but I know people who have wealth, because we're talking about money, right? There's money, there's disposable income, and then there's like wealth, right? There's different levels of money, what do you mean by money? But I know people who have so much money and they're so unhappy because money leads to also problems. Like money, disposable income, great because better material conditions, less struggle, more opportunity, right? Makes things a bit easier. Yeah. But then once you get to wealth, stuff seems to go south in relationships.
You've got to be able to meet all your basic needs, right? You've got to have a roof over your head, especially in the kind of society where we live, where if you don't have money, it's not just the fact that you like can't go out and have fun. It's like you're not going to be able to pay your rent.
Yeah.
You're not going to be able to, like, so obviously you're not going to be in a good position to be able to go out and meet people then. Yeah. But so there is actually some research here that
come
in
on,
the US.
Grace.
I know. I'm bringing in the research.
Come on.
there is actually some research in the US that showed that. $70,000 a year income is the point at which your happiness peaks. And after that, having more income doesn't make you more happy.
Okay.
And actually, like you said, some of the wealthiest people can be really, really unhappy. Have you guys watched Succession?
Oh, no. Yeah.
Like those kinds of relationships where your whole family environment is built around competition, power, dominance over other people. Like that is...
And
almost the opposite
this
of love.
Kind of
and also it erodes
society.
Trust. It erodes trust. And like money in relationships has to have a basis of trust. Mm. And that erodes trust when you get to excess wealth.
It's always the people that have lots of money that are talking about it's nothing. Do you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah. We don't think it's nothing.
It's easy to say that.
You've got to be able to have some. Like $70,000
I'm just saying, if I'm going to be depressed and crying, I'd rather cry in a Bentley.
That's a quote, and I've already heard it from someone else.
I'm just saying, I'd rather do it. That's what.
Who said that wasn't
it? It is a point, though. It is a point because, like, you know, it's very easy as someone who's like, you know, come from like a relatively well-off background to say, oh, well, money doesn't make you happier.
Yeah.
But I think if you grow up without a lot of wealth and without security, then obviously you're going to say, well, yeah, you want like a basic level of security to be able to live your life.
It makes everything better.
But also like,
I just don't think it does.
Okay, wait, let me jump in. So you are clearly very, very steadfast in what you believe, which is fine.
Yeah.
But I want to jump into Grace and Gina because you're clearly on the money can't buy you love.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel that you could fall in love with no money present at all in your partner?
I mean, I have.
Okay. Did it go well?
No.
Well, I mean, clearly not. Not because of the money.
Right.
But I mean, I've dated like, you know, very wealthy people who've come from like, you know, very posh backgrounds and like people who've come from like, you know, who haven't really got any money to speak of whatsoever. And those things haven't been what have defined the relationship in any way, shape or form.
Same
but that's also because like, it's not a fact of me because I'm independent and I have my own source of income.
Okay.
It's like, I'm not going to rely on someone else to buy me things or give me money. It's just like a question of, you know, are they secure in their life, right? Because if they're not, if they're like unhappy or they can't
afford
to do things
for
themselves,
yeah.
That's obviously going to be a problem. I'm going to want to support them.
Right.
And if they're like so wealthy that they're so obsessed with their job, like, investment bankers, I would never go there again.
Okay, what about you, Gina?
I mean, me and my partner,
well, you've got a naked drummer man from Budapest.
Yeah, so basically, no, we didn't have any money.
You're right, okay.
And I was living in a storeroom of a pub on a single camp bed with a friend for 9 months, working for no money in London, because I'm from up north, with a window that didn't shut and a cat, I don't know where it came from. So, like, I was in this storeroom.
So you need your own episode of this show.
No.
We need to just do it off the table for you.
But this, like, fully, this, like, man took me and my friend in, because we didn't have any money, we didn't know him, and we were like, this is going to turn out bad, but we have nowhere else to live. So.
Right.
I was living there. Geordie was like working, like paying £600 a month for a room and doing labour, and he couldn't afford the rent. And neither of us had any money. And it went on like that for like probably 3.5 years. But there was enough in us as people, like we just clicked as people. And I think like money is a transactional thing that we need under capitalism and great. But like love is humanity, it's people.
Okay.
And like money really murky stuff hard, but like if you get each other and there's love there and there's respect there, and if you talk and there's trust, like, I don't think money buys you that.
Do you think that the fact that you're always in the struggle together helped bring you lot closer? Because if maybe, if you had the money and he was still in the position that he was in, that could have grated on the relationship.
Yeah, definitely, because when there's a power dynamic that's off, that's when stuff goes wrong. So if I had loads of money and he didn't, it would have been probably a lot harder. That's probably fair.
Do you guys, let me ask you this question then, based on what you just said. Do you feel like your financial status in your relationship determines who wears the trousers? I'm going to do "where's the trousers" in quotes. Do you feel like you just said, if I had loads of money and he didn't, then maybe you would make different decisions and maybe a relationship wouldn't be where it is?
Yeah, I think it depends, because like, what do you mean by "wear the trousers"? Like, the thing is
calls the shots, if we talk about the power dynamic in a relationship, you're the person who's able to call the shots, you determine where you're going today. There's almost even sometimes an unspoken level of power.
Yes, that can
where
happen.
The person naturally feels a little bit submissive to the fact that the other person in the relationship earns more money than they do.
We've been in situations where our incomes have fluctuated so much since we've been together, together for 9 years, and like, just situations have changed where like, I've had more money, or he's had more money, and there is an unspoken feeling of like, yeah, well, it's easy for you to do that and I can't do that. So like, you want to buy this thing, you know, and I'm like, yeah, I'll buy it, we've got a puppy, I'll buy it, I'll buy the £200 crate because she needs it. Yeah. And he's like, well, good for you, I can't pay you back, you know. And right. I'm like, well, it's fine, don't worry about it. And he's like, yeah, but I don't feel good about that. Yeah, but we just have to keep talking about it.
What do you mean?
Yeah, but okay, the other option is dog has no crate.
Yeah, but no, that's what I'm trying to say. I don't know if, like, it's like those traditional gender roles and stuff that you hear, and you know, growing up, you're supposed to be raised a certain way and be a man. So when you're not be able to provide in your relationship, it doesn't do good things for your ego.
Are you speaking generally or for you specifically? You wouldn't feel like you could call shots in your relationship if your partner earned.
Not necessarily call shots, but even for me, and probably a lot of men out there, like, it's like a woman being able to treat you and trying to do things, whatever. If I can afford it and she wants to do that, then it feels totally different to if I can't afford it.
Right.
And she wants to do that. She wants to go out to eat in nice places and stuff like this, and I can't afford it. She's like, it's all right, I'll take you. But me within myself, not being able to do it, I don't even want to go.
There is a point, which is that, like, you know, we live in a society in which masculinity is constructed in a certain way. And it's like, if you cannot pay the bills, if you do not earn a certain amount, then that takes a toll on, like, who you consider to be
as a person.
Yeah. Right. And you know what? A lot of the, like, really horrible, regressive stuff that happens in our society, particularly, you know, violence perpetrated by men, is around, I don't feel good enough to live up to these stereotypes, so I'm going to assert my dominance other ways.
Yes.
And that's really regressive and negative. But again, it's not always, there is obviously, everyone has to take responsibility for their own behavior, but the fact that we have those social constructs is not on individuals. It's about the way that we conceive of success, the way we conceive of power, the way we conceive of, like, what it means to be a man. Mm-hmm.
But it's almost to ask ourselves those questions, though. So, like, if it's really important to your masculinity and you as a man to be able to provide with money, like, fine, that's you, that's your life. But you also have to sit there and be like, why is that? Where did that come from? You know, we have to ask ourselves those questions to figure out if they're coming from a good, healthy place or from a place of where we've been told we have to
but
do
regardless
it.
Regardless of where they come from, they're not going to be able to change overnight. It's what I've known my whole life. It's what I know. It's gone into my belief system, innit?
So would you let go of, if you were in love, in a relationship, you were happy and something happens where you're at one point not earning as much as your partner. Yeah. She wants to take you out. She wants to do X, Y, Z. Would you let go of that relationship based on that one point? I'm not earning enough and I don't feel good as a man.
Maybe.
What?
When I was younger.
Okay, cool. Oh,
thank God. I was like,
your rising causes are really, really perfect.
Come on.
So maybe when you were younger.
Yeah, maybe when I was younger, you could, because you self-destruct, you damage the relationship. Yeah. You know what I'm trying to say, and you push people away.
And what's changed for you now?
And you just get older and wiser. You know, it's cliche, but like, obviously, like, money and stuff like that doesn't really define you as a person, innit? Mm. You know what I'm trying to say?
Or your love.
Well. And everybody's allowed to fall on hard times. And if you're in a relationship, in a solid relationship, you're supposed to be there for each other and support each other, you know what I'm trying to say? So it's totally different from going through bad times or just being like a total bum. Mm. You know what I'm saying? But if you are a bum, you don't have no hopes and no ambitions and no dreams, and you're not even worrying about those things anyway. It's if you have ambitions to do better where the problem comes from. So you want to do better, you want to do more, but you can't because of the situation that you're in.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Obviously,
just going through life, you just learn that things happen, innit?
I also think that's a cliche, though. I think very few people sit in poverty or no money and just be like, most people want to climb out of situations that are struggle.
There's examples of everyone in every situation, but I agree with you.
I think majority, most people don't want to be in struggle.
And a lot of women are enablers.
Okay. Again, different show. I feel like Margs, especially you two, Margs and Gina are just like, there's so many things I'd like to talk about.
Oh, yes.
I think, you know, there is this really dangerous narrative we have here, right, which is that people who are living in poverty are lazy, whereas actually, you know, if you are living in that situation of extreme poverty where you can barely afford to meet your own needs, we know from psychological research that that takes a toll on your mental well-being, on your mental health, on your physical health.
Yeah.
It creates this cycle.
Which will probably put you in a very difficult position to try and go out and find love, right?
Exactly. Yeah, and you know, the thing that is at the core of a lot of this is we tell people who are not, you know, like doing extremely well or like earning loads of money, you are basically worthless, right? Mm-hmm. We tell people if you don't earn enough money, you are worthless, you don't deserve love, you don't deserve any of these things. Yeah. So of course it's gonna take a toll on your relationships yourself, but the answer to that isn't to say, well, just be a bit better.
Yes.
It's actually like, how do we build a society in which everyone has
less
that sense
people
of security?
Are in this situation
I feel like Margs, Grace is speaking directly to you. She's saying you should try and find love no matter what money is in your pocket at this time.
No, but I actually believe that if you don't have a certain amount of money or certain things going on for yourself, then maybe you shouldn't even be looking for relationships and women.
Deserve joy if you're poor? You don't deserve love and joy if you're poor? What?
No, but it's like, if you're not trying to... You're worried
they deserve
about
it the most.
Nah, you're worried about all the wrong things. If you're not trying to better yourself and take yourself out of the situation...
You can do both. People can do more than one thing. They can look for a job and build their lives and work hard to get out, lift themselves out of poverty. And they can also enjoy love and joy. They have to.
Yeah,
because
if
you don't love and joy
no money,
in your life, it's very hard to do the other thing.
If you ain't got no money, what are you doing swanning around in bars with women and stuff?
You
like
don't
so
have to go to a bar
here,
to find
so
love. I love that you think love is only available in the bar.
Yeah,
in the bars,
on ice. It's
like higher chances of finding them in bars.
I hear you, Margs. Yeah.
Really? Have you ever had a relationship outside in a bar?
You know,
I have not had a good relationship outside in a bar.
I look forward to there being some kind of dating show based around you trying to find love in different bars up and around the country.
I would definitely watch it.
We could honestly talk about this for a while. There's so much to get to, but I appreciate you guys being here today. Thank you for sharing your thoughts. Margs, good luck.
Good luck.
I wish you all the best.
I'll be fine, I'll be all right.
He's got money.
Gina, thank you so much. Margs, thank you. Grace, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure to speak to you guys today. And thank you for helping me take money and relationships off the table.